Good morning again. It's a joy to worship with all of you this morning. Now, since you're here today, you're here in a church on a Sunday morning, in a church service, listening to a sermon. I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to assume that every person here is at least somewhat open to the idea that God exists. Everyone here, I'm almost positive, is at least willing to consider the idea that there's a higher power. Well, Christianity proclaims that it's not just a power that's over all, but it's a person who we call God. But if God exists, or if we're even willing to grant that he might exist, then you might be wondering something. You might ask, if God exists, what does he want? Everyone wonders about that question. What does God want? What is God's purpose? What is his desire for the world? What exactly is supposed to be happening? Christians sometimes ask the question this way. They say, what is the will of God? And they just mean, what does God want? What does God want for me? What is the will of God? They want to know God's desire for them. They'd like to know what God wants them to do. Well, I have good news for you today. Today, I'm going to tell you exactly what God's will is for your life. Or rather, it's not going to be me. The Apostle Paul is going to do that in the passage we're going to look at today. So if you're not already there, please turn your Bible to Romans chapter 8. We're looking at verses 26 through 30 today. If you want to use that red Bible that's in the seat back in front of you, it's on page 598. So Romans chapter 8, big 8, little numbers 26 through 30. Once you are there, I'd ask that if you're able, you please stand to honor the reading of God's word, and then follow along as I'll read our passage for today. Romans 8, verses 26 through 30. Starting in verse 26, the Apostle Paul writes this. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time this morning. Time we had to worship you, celebrate baptism, representing what you have done to save us. In this moment too, God, I ask that you will be our focus right now. May we not be distracted by anything else in our lives or even the one bringing the message, but may you be the focus. To borrow words from John the Baptist, may you increase, may I decrease. Lord, may what we say here today lead us to see how the Holy Spirit intercedes for us and how your will is for your people to be conformed to the image of your Son. Encourage us to trust in your purposes for us that cannot fail. It's in your Son's name, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Let's take a moment to think about where we are in the Bible. Once again, we are in the Apostle Paul's letter to the early church in the city of Rome, otherwise known as the Book of Romans, that he wrote sometime around the year 57 AD. In this book, Paul covers a lot. He talks about the sin and rebellion that separates us from God. And then he describes how faith or trust in the person and work of Jesus Christ is the only way that we can be restored to a right relationship with God. Now, for the past few weeks, we've been looking at Romans chapter 8. We began in the beginning of the chapter by learning that there is no condemnation for those who have a relationship with Christ Jesus. And since that is true, we should live a life that is controlled by the Holy Spirit. Then we talked about how believers in Jesus should kill sin in their lives because they've been adopted by God and they will receive his inheritance. Last week, we talked about how creation and every believer groans for Christ to return. But for now, they must wait patiently in hope. Well, confidently waiting in hope for Christ's return, that's a helpful thing. But in our passage today, Paul says that believers in Jesus not only have hope that God will save us, but God's Holy Spirit intercedes for us now. The Holy Spirit intercedes for us. Listen to verses 26 and 27 again. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes, prays on our behalf for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Just as we have help in the daily struggles of this life through our hope for the future, well, we also have help because God's Holy Spirit is living in us. He is another helper. Before his crucifixion and resurrection, Jesus promised this to his disciples. He said, "I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you." The Holy Spirit is this promised helper. All true believers in Jesus Christ have the Holy Spirit living inside them. The third person of the Trinity lives in those who know God. Now, there's much that the Holy Spirit does for us, but in this passage, Paul is talking about how he helps us to pray. He helps us to pray because we do not always know how to pray as God truly wants. We don't know the way we ought to pray. So he intercedes for us. He prays for us. The Holy Spirit makes intercession between us and God. He tells God what we really need. The phrase that Paul uses, a kind of a beautiful phrase, the end of verse 26, he does that with groanings too deep for words, or wordless groans that cannot be uttered. Now, this is not speaking in tongues. It's the Holy Spirit praying to God on our behalf. It's like how a mother can usually understand her child's baby talk or a child's crying. Even though it sounds like nonsense to everyone else, the mother knows exactly what her child needs, sometimes even before the child knows. A mother can distinguish between a hungry cry, a sleepy cry, and a needs-to-be-changed cry. And in that same way, God understands us, even when we don't use words. Sometimes we pray and pray and pray, and we come to a place where we do not know what to pray for anymore. We are nearly overwhelmed by our need. When we reach that point in prayer, we're still really praying, even if no words leave our lips or even if no words are running through our minds. Now, this isn't like Eastern religions emptying your mind. Paul's saying that when we run out of things to pray for, when we don't know what to pray anymore, the Holy Spirit prays for us. Now, it might be a scary thought to trust someone else, let alone God's Holy Spirit, to pray for us, but we can have confidence in what the Holy Spirit says to God on our behalf. Because God knows the Holy Spirit, and he knows us. He searches our hearts and minds. That's what verse 27 says. He knows our deepest thoughts and desires. In Jeremiah 17:10, God says, "But I, the Lord, search all hearts and examine secret motives. I give all people their due rewards according to what their actions deserve." God knows every person's mind. There's nothing hidden from him. And that's why it's so great that the Holy Spirit prays for us, because he can say what we really mean. God understands what he is saying on our behalf. At the very end of verse 27, Paul reminds us again that the Holy Spirit is interceding on behalf of God's people, the saints, according to the will of God. He intercedes, he pleads for every believer in harmony with God's will and purposes for us. This means that we have so much help on our side. If you look down the page or up on the screen to verse 34, we read this: "Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us." Now, we'll talk more about that verse next week. But for today, look, here in that verse, we see Jesus is interceding for us. He's representing us. And in our passage, verses 26 and 27, the Holy Spirit is also interceding for us before God. With all that help on our side, God must hear and respond to prayers that honor him. Practically, this means exactly what the Apostle John said in 1 John 5:14. He says, "This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us." If the Holy Spirit is praying for it, it must be God's will. Now, as I was looking at these verses, I realized that I had a personal experience with this groaning too deep for words recently. I'd had a particularly stressful day, and I found myself alone in this room in the sanctuary long after everyone else had left. I was exhausted, I was drained, I was at the end of myself. And so I laid down right here on these steps, and the best way I can describe what happened is verse 26 happened. I was lost for answers. I had no idea what I should do. All I felt was sadness, pain, and a desperate need for God. I didn't know what to say. I had no idea what to pray or to ask him. So I didn't say anything. And even though I didn't say any words, I knew that I was praying. When we feel that we are at the end of ourselves, when we don't know what to do, the Holy Spirit prays for us. He knows what we need, and he asks God for it. The Holy Spirit prays for what we need. And that is such an encouraging truth. We can trust the Holy Spirit's prayers because God is interested in doing good in our lives. However, we have to define good the way God does. And for God, good is to be conformed, to be shaped, to be molded to the image of Christ. For God, good is to be conformed to the image of Christ. Listen to verses 28 and 29 again. "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers." Verse 28 tells us that God works all things together for good in our lives. But verse 29 explains that good means that we would be conformed, that we would become like Jesus Christ. So this is what I promised you at the very beginning. God's will for you is that you would be conformed to the image of his Son. God's purpose for you is that you would become like Jesus. Paul tells us that God is the one who causes all things to come together for our good. They do not just fall into place on their own. And this doesn't happen for every person on earth, but for those who love God, for those who are committed to him. Dr. Michael Smith was a professor who taught a class I had on the book of Romans when I was in college. And he warned us. He said, "Never read Romans 8:28 without Romans 8:29. And why did he say that? Because we want to define the good in verse 28, by our wants and our needs, but God defines it in line with his ultimate purpose for us. And what is that purpose? To be conformed to Christ. In other words, we are copying Christ. We are being made like him. He is the perfect model that we are seeking to emulate. The truth is, no person stands still. We're always growing and changing on the inside. If you really think about it, and over your life, your personality has probably changed a little. Your preferences have changed. Certain foods you one time liked, now you don't, or vice versa. Your likes and dislikes, they change as you age. And in the same way, we are always changing spiritually. We're either becoming more like Jesus, or we're becoming more like Satan. God's will is that his people would be like his Son, Jesus Christ. The purpose of this is so that Christ would be the firstborn, verse 29 tells us. The firstborn, the most important among many brothers and sisters, among those who have a relationship with God. In Colossians 1, 15 and 18, Paul tells us about Jesus, that he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn, the most important of all creation. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. He might be most important. Christ should have the highest place of honor and privilege. But here's the good news about that. He wants others to share in that happiness. To be saved, we must acknowledge that Jesus is our Lord and Master, but he also wants to be our brother and our friend. If we have a relationship with Jesus, we are his brothers and sisters. We are a part of his family. It is for our good. God's purposes, his will for his people is always good. And this truth is present throughout Scripture. The author of Ecclesiastes 8:12 acknowledges that although a sinner does evil 100 times and may lengthen his life, still I know that it will be well for those who fear God. Now, when it says fear God, it doesn't mean that they're afraid of him. It means they honor him. They trust what he is doing in their lives. Our passage here in Romans, it's not saying that more good things happen to Christians than happen to non-Christians. It's saying that God uses everything that happens in a Christian's life to make the believer more like Jesus. That is what the good in verse 28 means. God rules over our trials so that they do good to us. There's a pastor named Milton Vincent, and he wrote in a book called The Gospel Primer. And he said, "The good news about my trials is that God is forcing them to bow to his gospel purposes. He is forcing trials to bow to his purposes and do good to me by improving my character and making me more conformed to the image of Christ." Friends, our trials and suffering are not wasted. They are used by God to build our character, to make us more like Jesus. Now, we can't often do it right in the moment, but eventually, someday, we'll be able to look back on our struggles and see how God used them for his good work. Because with God, there are no true accidents. Proverbs 16:33 says, the dice is cast in the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. Everything that happens is used by God for the fulfillment of his will. It's used by him to accomplish his purposes. In the New Testament, James 1, 2-4 puts it this way. James says, "Count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." If you know Christ, what you are going through in your life right now, it has a purpose. I know it may be hard. I know that at times it may feel unbearable, but God is working in your life. He is molding, he is forming you into the man or woman that he wants you to be. He is turning you into a reflection of Jesus Christ. You are becoming someone who acts like Jesus. God's will for every person who believes in him is that they would be conformed to the image of his Son. Paul puts it this way in 1 Thessalonians 4:3, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification." Sanctification, growing in holiness, being conformed to the image of Christ, they all mean the same thing. God wants us to grow to be like Jesus. That is his will for us. Now, I realize that that doesn't really answer specific questions you might have. That doesn't tell you, well, what choice should I make in this situation, right here? It doesn't give you clear answers to those big questions. Who should I marry? What job should I take? Where should I live? But I think this answer is a better answer, because it tells us that wherever we go and whatever we do is used by God to make his people more like Jesus. So rather than worry about specific answers to our questions, Paul is challenging us to trust God's purposes for our lives. As we trust him, we seek to know him more and grow closer to him. In most cases, it's better for us to focus on what God is doing, to focus on how he is using the specific circumstances of our lives to make us like Christ. God has specifically prepared a recipe, a prescription individually tailored to your life. If he gave you the life of the person sitting to your left or to your right, well, that wouldn't make you like Jesus. He knows what he is doing. He is giving you what you need. In the words of the English pastor John Newton, everything is needful that he sends. Nothing can be needful that he withholds. Everything he gives us is what we need. If he doesn't give it to us, then we don't need it. Now, as I was thinking about this passage, I remember that when I was in college, a pastor spoke and he challenged the students at the college to pray something every day. And so I took him up on that challenge. And nearly every day I pray this prayer, whatever it takes, make me like Jesus. And I'm going to give you that same challenge today. Will you commit to pray every day, whatever it takes, make me like Jesus? Now, before you say yes, I have a warning for you. God takes that request very seriously. If you pray that, and if you mean it, he will do it. And whatever means whatever. Whatever God needs to do to you to draw you closer to him, whatever he needs to do to conform you to the image of his son Jesus, that's what he's going to do. He will stop at nothing to make you like Jesus. A few years after I started praying that prayer daily, I found myself at a place of life that I was upset. I was upset by some struggles, some disappointments. I was depressed for a while. My life wasn't going the way I wanted it to go. But then suddenly one day it hit me that, wait a minute, I've been praying this prayer every day. And so I finally understood that everything that has happened to me, everything that is happening to me, and everything that will happen to me is God's answer to that prayer. Any blessings or trials that come my way are part of how God conforms me to the image of his son. So friends, if you pray that prayer, you could be in for a rough time. In fact, most likely you will be. God will grow and stretch you in ways that you may not want, in ways you may not like. Things may happen to you that you never dreamed or imagined or would have wished on your worst enemy. But you know what? It is worth it. God will make you more like Jesus. You will experience greater joy, peace, and freedom than ever before. It will prepare you for an eternity with him. God wants to conform you to the image of his son. Will you pray, whatever it takes, make me like Jesus? Paul ends our passage, this section, by explaining God's purpose for his people, God's purpose for us. Listen to verses 29 and 30 one last time. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Several commentaries I read about this passage describe these verses as a chain. That's why I have this picture of a chain up. It is a chain of God's grace for those who believe in him. In these two verses, there are five words, five verbs, five links in this chain of God's work on our behalf. Each verb in these verses is connected to the next. You can't have one without the others. If God does one of these things in this list for someone, he will do all of them. Look at the text. The text doesn't say some of those he foreknew or some of those he predestined. It doesn't say most of those he called, most of those he justified. It just says those. Paul is telling us what God does for every single person who believes in him. Now, I know there's a temptation with some of the words in these verses. Our eyes can glaze over, like, oh, I don't want to talk about those kind of things. But these two verses are some of the most encouraging in the entire Bible. This is what God does for us. This is what gives us the confidence and hope to go through life. So let's talk about those five words. The first is foreknew. Verse 29, for those whom he foreknew. This means that God set his love on us. He chose us to know him personally. He knew us before we knew him. He loved us before we loved him. Now, there's some who say foreknow means that God looked into the future. He saw who would believe in him. But I don't know, that seems a little unlikely to me. Because in the Bible, to know someone is to know them personally, not just to know something about them. Consider Jesus' words here in Matthew. He's talking about in the last days, Matthew 7, 22 and 23. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not do these things? Did we not prophesy in your name, cast out demons, perform many miracles? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Jesus knew who they were. He knew who these people were, but he did not know them. He did not have a relationship with them. To foreknow is to know someone in advance. Now, my goal today is not to argue about the meaning of words, but to encourage us with the words of this passage. If God knows us, then he predestines us, then he saves us. If we have a relationship with Jesus, if we are growing to be more like him, it is because God knew us before we were born. The opening two verses in 1 Peter are this: Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, he's writing to elect, chosen, saved exiles, believers. They're in these territories: Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia. He's writing to them. They were chosen by God, and here's why: according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ, and for sprinkling with his blood. And Peter says, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. They were chosen before God knew them. They are being conformed, sanctified in the image of his Son, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. They are able to obey Christ because his blood, his death, has justified them. Peter in this passage is saying the same thing Paul is in ours. Now, the second word in these two verses is predestined, predestined. God has chosen his people. He has planned a glorious destination for our lives' journeys. And predestination is not a word to be scared of. It's an encouraging truth to embrace. The Lord has a plan for us. God has prepared the road for us. He will be with us on the way. He will bring us to the end. Remember, we've been talking about what that end is. Yes, those who believe in Jesus go to heaven, but God's will, his goal, is that they are conformed to the image of Christ. God doesn't just want people to be in heaven. He wants them to be like Jesus. The next two verbs, we see them in verse 30. They explain God's work in the present time. He called us and he justified us. Now, in Scripture, called can mean someone just hearing about God. But here, Paul's talking about someone who has heard God and responded. God gives them a desire to know him, and they seek after that desire. He has specifically called them to come to him. That word justified, well, that's what the whole book of Romans is about. Because of the person and work of Jesus Christ, believers are restored to a right relationship with God. This is what we're normally talking about when we say that someone is saved. We mean they've been justified. We mean they've been saved from sin. They've been restored to a closer relationship with God. They've been declared not guilty before the Lord. They will not be punished for their sins because Christ took their punishment on their behalf. They have a right standing before God. These two words, I've talked about them together, called and justified, because they're the easiest ways to know that God is working in our lives. If we have felt drawn to God, if we have turned away from our sin toward faith and trust in Jesus Christ, well, that means we have been justified. But if you have turned to Christ, if you trust him now, then you know him. If you haven't, then you are still separated from him. So if you do not know him, friend, believe in Jesus. Come to know him. Be made right with God. You will be justified. It's an amazing truth, but it's only part of what God does for us. After giving examples of sins that had separated the Corinthians from God, Paul writes this: such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God. All of God's works on our behalf, they're all tied together. If one happens, then they all do. Now I'll come back to the fifth and the last verb that we'll see in just a few moments. But first I want us to think again about these chain of words. Paul's point to the Roman Christians in these two verses is that this process will happen. This chain will not be broken. If God knows us, then he chooses to save us. If he predestines us, then he calls us to salvation. If he calls us, then he justifies us. He makes us right with him. If he justifies us, he will glorify us. If you have a relationship with God today, that means that God knew you and he chose you. It also means that he will bring you home to be with him. It's going to happen. God's purpose for his people never fails. I heard a recent song from the Christian artist Matthew West called Unplanned, and it had this really great lyric that stuck with me. As long as my God holds the world in his hands, I know that there's no such thing as unplanned. Nothing happens to us by accident or without purpose. And verses 29 and 30, they're closely connected to verse 28. God does nothing but good for his people. It started in eternity past when he knew them and he chose his people. And in their recent past, now, he's justified them and saved them. In the future, he will glorify them. So finally, the fifth verb in these verses, let us know that we will be glorified. We will be glorified. The Lord will give us his glory. God will complete his plan for us in eternity. He will completely remove our sin and remove our sin nature. We will be perfect from the inside out. Jesus prayed this in John 17:22. He says to God, the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one, just as we are one. Now, what's really interesting about this word in verse 30, glorified, is that it's in the past tense. It's in the past tense. Typically, when we speak in the past, we use words like, I went somewhere, I listened, I learned, I heard. We're talking about something we've already done. We're talking about something that's already happened to us. But here, when it says glorified in the past tense, it's referring to God's decision that he made before time began to give his people his glory. Even though we don't have the fullness of it yet, God has determined that he will do it. It is absolutely certain. It is guaranteed to happen. In Philippians 1:6, Paul says this, he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. God's purpose for his people who love him is for their good. He knows them, he chooses them, he calls them, he makes them right with him, and he gives them his glory. And that means that God is in control of everything, and his glory always shines through. Whether it is a rough situation in your personal life, things going on in your job, or issues at church, God gets the glory. If you know Jesus, it's not because of something you did, but because of God's great work on your behalf. You can live with confidence and boldness because he is in control. The message to all of us is the same. Trust God because he has our best interest at heart. If you do not know him, well then ask someone how you can know him. Ask how you can turn from sin toward faith in Jesus Christ. Love to take as long as you need to have that conversation with you. If you know him, though, God's will for you is that you would be conformed to the image of Christ. He wants you to become like Jesus. It's not something you have to do by your own effort. The Holy Spirit will pray for you, and God has already purposed to do this work in your life. He knew you and chose you before you were born. He has called you and justified you now. He will glorify you in the future. So, friends, let's praise God for what he has done for us, because he alone is worthy.